The award for poetry this year went to Mark Strand for his book, Blizzard of One. It's Strand's 9th book of poetry. He has also published several books of translations, edited poetry anthologies, and written books for children. A former U.S. Poet Laureate, Strand now teaches at the Committee on Social Thought at the University of Chicago. Congratulations and thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
You've received many prestigious literary awards and the MacArthur Genius Fellowship. Does the Pulitzer bring even more attention?
I think it does, although the MacArthur brought quite a bit, but I mean, this is staggering. I mean the phone never stops ringing. I'm glad I'm here now. I don't have to answer the phone.
I'm very interested in your ideas about how a poem works. You said, quote, a poem releases itself, secretes itself slowly, sometimes almost poisonously, into the mind of the reader. How do you think poetry does that?
Well, I think a lot of it depends on the reader. The reader has to sort of give him or herself over to the poem and allow the poem to inhabit him. And how does the poem do that? It does it by rearranging the world in such a way that it appears new. It does it by using language that is slightly different from the way language is used in the workaday world, so that you're forced to pay attention to it.
And it works differently than fiction, doesn't it?
Well, fiction draws you out of yourself. Fiction creates a world into which you can imagine yourself. You identify with characters. You move in a plot that is different from the plot you live in every day. Poetry, I think, draws you into yourself, and you engage with the world in a different way. I mean, you engage with the world as you know it, but slightly altered. It's still your world. It's not a world of other people.
And this seems related to something else you've said, which is that the poet's obligation isn't to the audience primarily, but to the language that he hopes he's perpetuating. Explain that.
Well, I don't think anyone is a poet unless they've read other poems. And I think every poet knows that he exists in a continuum, and that continuum is made up of the language in which he writes. And I think the poet assumes that obligation to continue the best that's in the language.
Let's see how this works with your poetry. Would you read a suite of appearances for us?
Yeah, be happy to. In another time, we will want to know how the earth looked then and were people the way we are now. In another time, the records they left will convince us that we are unchanged and could be at ease in the past and not alone in the present, and we shall be pleased. But beyond all that, what cannot be seen or explained will always be elsewhere, always supposed, invisible even beneath the signs, the beautiful surface, the uncommon knowledge that point its way. In another time, what cannot be seen will define us, and we shall be prompted to say that language is error, and all things are wronged by representation. The self, we shall say, can never be seen with a disguise, and never be seen without one.
So this poem sort of illustrates what you said, the rhythm of that first line. In another time, we will want to know how the earth looked then and were people the way we are now. It does insinuate itself.
Well, we'll be both at home in the world, but the truth of the world or the truth of ourselves will always be a little beyond us. There'll always be something that we don't know.
I'm not asking you notice any more about what it means, because you've said poetry isn't reducible. It's not a representation of anything, that it doesn't exactly mean or stand for something. Explain that.
Well, it can. I mean, it depends on what kind of poet you are. Some poets pay very close attention to the world and try to represent it verbally. Other poets try to create another world through which we see the so-called real world. And it's hoped that through the imaginary world that they create that we see the real world more clearly. I mean, I think what poetry finally does is to help us experience our world as intensely as possible.
What do you look for when you read a poem?
I look for astonishment. I look to be moved, to have my view of the world in which I live somewhat changed, enlarged. I want both to belong more strongly to it, or more emphatically to it, and yet to be able to see it, to have, it's almost a paradox to say this, a more compassionate distance.
Hmm. And when you write, Mr. Strand, do you write in longhand?
I do.
Why?
Well, I think when I write, I try to resist reading my poems as long as possible, and type seems too final. While I'm writing longhand, I'm under the illusion that I'm hearing the poem. Type seems almost like print, and you're fooled into thinking, or I'm often fooled into thinking a poem is done before it's actually done, if I see it in print.
Do ideas come easily for you?
No.
How
clearly,
do you get them?
I'm a rather slow thinker. Huh?
How do they come to you?
Well, they come at any time. I can be walking down the street and the word oxtail can pop into mind, and then field and, you know, sky. Or I can be reading a book and suddenly misread a line, and that could be a line of a poem. It could be extracted from a conversation. I'm always finding things said that strike me as charming and useful.
When you get a line, how long then does it usually take to create the poem?
Well, it all depends. Some poems come immediately. Some poems are almost finished as, you know, they're written. Other poems take months, and I've written on a poem for a year or two.
And here's a question, excuse me for asking it, but many people want to know this. Can you make a living writing poetry, or do you have to do something else like teach?
Well, I think you have to teach. You don't get paid very much for poems, and even if you were a very successful poet and wrote a lot of poems and published them and were asked to give many, many public readings, it would be very, very hard to scratch out a living that way.
So this is a statement about about poetry in our society today.
Well, I mean, it's a statement. Poetry is not a well-paid endeavor. On the other hand, it's one of the nice things about poetry. If you don't feel the pressure of being paid for what you do, you're free to do what you like.
Mm-hmm. I see what you mean. Well, thank you very much, Mr. Strand, and congratulations again.
Thanks.